having me here and giving me the opportunity to talk about doing this double feature and talk about two topics which I really enjoyed, which all have to do something with Java. And I think especially for developers and people who are involved in mobile software development, also with Java, will be pretty excited about what's going on there and what's possible with Java. The first talk I'm doing is about Java on iOS, and the second one will be for an open source project we started early this year. It's called Data Robot for Android. It's a kind of object relational mapper, but a little bit different from the other ones you might know already. So I get started with Java on iOS. So the first question is, why do I need this, or what is the motivation behind this? And the general motivation is multi-platform development. We want to reuse as much source code or components as possible between different mobile platforms. Typically, if you look at the market, it's iOS and Android. So it's really a tough decision to make. There are several things you can approach this. The first thing you can do is say, okay, I will develop several native apps for multi-platform development, and we use just the concepts behind it, the architectural ideas, and yeah, the business knowledge and the way how synchronization works, or the business rules, or I can use something like mobile gateways where I push as much as possible of the data logic into the server, into the backends, so that our mobile applications, the Android apps and the iOS apps will be really stupid, really thin clients without much knowledge. And another approach, which is very common, is the hybrid approach, using frameworks like Cordova or Accelerator, Titanium. Here we have some kind of native framework with an embedded web view, and this web view basically presents HTML5 JavaScript-based applications. So, but yeah, I will not go into the details of the pros and cons of each topic, because this each one could be a whole talk for a day. So, but there are also other alternatives which you might not have on your radar yet. One approach is using MDST, model-driven architecture approaches. There are frameworks like Afonical or Applause, where you create with Xtext. I don't know if you're familiar with the Eclipse tooling and Eclipse modeling framework. You can create DSLs, domain-specific languages, describing the mobile domain and generating platform-specific solutions. It's really hard to maintain the generators, and it's very abstract, so I think I started actually doing mobile with a mobile model-driven approach, but it's kind of dead end because many people don't understand it, because it's difficult to get started with it. So another thing you can do is use native bridges and reuse your code using JavaScript. There are tools like Transit from BMAP, where this guy, Heiko Behrens, really great speaker. He has some videos also on YouTube for other talks. He created this framework where he specifies all his logic, the networking, the persistence, everything in JavaScript, and reuses this JavaScript on Android and on iOS, and also on the server. So it's really one single source for the important bits in JavaScript, and can also dynamically send it to the clients and change the logic there and fix bugs, etc. It's really cool. There's another approach which is actually very common, especially in games, game development. It's using C++ for iOS and Android, and on Android accessing via the native development kit, and on iOS you can directly mix C++ with your Objective-C code. So the gap is a little bit lower on the iOS side. And with OpenGL, libraries it's, and different game engines, it's very common to use this approach. And we also using this if we want to build some multi-platform stuff with higher security requirements. We push a lot of the code and the logic into C and C++. So we have shared libraries which we can reuse for each platform. But we are here on the Java user group. So the question is, can I run Java on iOS? Yes, absolutely, you can do it. And there are two things how you can try to achieve that. The first one is you can use a transpiler code. Framework like J2Objc or XMLVM. It actually means that you transform Java source code into source code for the target platform. So J2Objc, which I will show you a little bit more in detail later, will transform Java source code to Objective-C source code, which you can then integrate into your Xcode environment and use as if it was written in Objective-C directly. And the other approach is using cross-compilers. You might have heard of Xamarin, which is well-known in the C#.NET environment, where you can write great applications with C# or Mono. And a very new framework, which I was lucky to get involved with for a customer project is RoboVM. And this is pretty similar to Xamarin, but instead of using C#, you use Java and cross-compile Java code, Java bytecode to native ARM code or x86 code. So let's get started, get our hands dirty, and look at J2Objc. I mentioned it's a transpiler. Transpiler means source code is transformed to source code. J2Objc actually is a project from Google, and on the marketing slides, on the website, they say that it's used heavily in Google Drive to port a lot of the code from the Android Google Drive app to iOS. And one important thing for J2Objc, especially if we compare it later to RoboVM, is that its purpose is to write non-UI code. So it's just for things like data access, application logic, and things which don't have a user interface. They say everything which is user experience, user interface related, has to be done in the native platform language. So that's their approach. But it's quite nice, and I think in many occasions it can be very, very powerful and useful because it supports most Java language and runtime features. You can use Java exceptions, inner classes, anonymous classes, generic types. What I found was great was you can use threading, Java threading, and it will run on iOS. And you can also use reflection. I put the most here in quotes because when I tried this with reflection, I had some problems. It works, but you have to structure your code or name your packages in a certain way so that it will work. But yeah, they're still working on it. You can find the project on GitHub, Google, J2Objc. And the code is currently in alpha or beta quality. So this is taken from the website. They say it's not production ready, but actually they used it in Google Drive, which has maybe a couple of users. 40. Yeah.
Do you know if it's ready for Java 8?
I haven't tried it yet with Java 8. but I believe I read something in the forum, in the user group, that they are working on this. For RoboVM, it's possible. I tried this out. This works since last week. Okay. So, but for J2Objc, yeah, I'm not sure. Let's look at a theoretical example, and I will do some live coding and show you in the IDE, so you believe me. Okay, so basically what you do, you have the J2Objc transpiler, you feed it with the Java source code, about here is really the source code. You let it run, and you will get .m file and .h file. If you is a little bit familiar with iOS, Objective-C, and Xcode. So the .h file is the header file, basically showing the signatures of the methods you can call, and the .n file contains the implementation of the signatures, where you implement all the logic and the important stuff goes into the .n file. And if you implement in Objective-C directly, you create .h and .m files all the time. It would be good to find out if they could generate Swift code. Maybe for the next release. So they have some other tools provided. One is the J2Objc-CC compiler, which is a shortcut for using the Xcode toolchain, build toolchain. You can feed it with the Hello World .m file that was generated from the transpile step, and you get an object file. If you've done embedded development or more C or C++ development, these are machine code binary very close to the hardware in the CPU type code, and you can create an executable. And here we can just call the hello executable with the main class. It's a wrapper around it. And so we can implement Java code and generate an x86 or an OS X, but it works also for Linux, binary out of it, which we run without a JDK and Java installed on it. I think which is also really a nice side effect of it. So there are two ways to integrate it into the development process. The first is use an external build, which means all steps, the scripts you have seen, there are Gradle and Maven plugins already, but you can also call directly the scripts, and you can do the compilation, get the resulting .h and .m files, copy them, or generate them directly into your Xcode folders, and use these classes as if they were written in Objective-C. Here the important thing is I would treat these classes as generated and would not modify them in Objective-C. It's like bytecode for me. It's an intermediate format, and if I want to change something in it, you need to change the Java code, because every time you regenerate, it gets overwritten. So, and this is maybe the cleanest way to integrate it and really have separated from the development steps. But there's also a more convenient way. It's you can generate an Xcode build rule, which will call all the J2Objc tooling and integrate directly the resulting .m.h class in the IDE. I will show you an example. Right. Can you read it? It's not sharp.
Seems like the whole projectors with the focus point.
Yeah. I don't know how to use it.
Just turn it.
Yeah.
big enough? Can you read it?
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Okay. Let's start. Right here. You see we have here a hello world.java file. Believe me, it's really simple. It's really easy. And I can call this command line and put it into scripts, because when I'm a little bit nervous and talks, I have a lot of typos. That would take too much of your time to watch me type. So I'm letting the compiler, Transpiler, run to look at the results. Now I have a .h file and a .m file. Have a look at it. Here we see we have a main method, and there are some conventions. If you have, for example, string parameters or string arrays, it will name the functions with the parameter types. It's an Objective-C thing, because the signatures look different in Objective-C than on Java. The syntax is a little bit different. And we also can look at the .m file and see the implementation. And if you're familiar with Objective-C development, say it's very functional code, but it's not easy to read or maintain code. So this is what I meant. You better not change the generated code. It's just an intermediate format, but yeah, it works. And the great thing is, if you use it, you can set breakpoints, and you can debug it in Xcode and really see what's going on under the hood. There's no magic, no magic libraries coming in doing some strange things. You can really see what's happening there. I also have another script. It's the two steps I showed you previously. It's compiling from the M file the object files and creating an binary file, an x86 file out. Now we have the hello executable, which is this generated wrapper. I give it the main class and I call the executable. Okay. So let's look at a little bit more advanced example. This is a regular Xcode project when you open up the Xcode IDE, and I modified it a little bit and added a build rule. And in this build rule, I basically just call the two tools we saw, the J2Objc transpiler, and move the generated code into another directory. Okay, in this derived file still. So here in my Xcode project, I have two example Java classes, Java files. Nothing special. This is just tested. And when I start the build process, the build rule is run, and behind the hood, this transpile stuff will happen. So if I want to use this code now, I open up my app delegate, which is basically the entry point of an iOS application, and I can simply allot in it the class I just generated as if it's a regular Objective-C class. There's some naming convention here. For those who don't know Objective-C, we don't have namespaces in Objective-C, so everything is done via class prefixes. And in the build rule, I just set for this package name, create the class prefix ACS, arconsis. So, but if you wondered where this ACS comes from,
it just called a constructor?
Yeah, the constructor alloc init is the Objective-C constructor. So here I have created the default constructor, created the object. And
it's
I
like newing and
yes.
instantiating an object
yes.
and initializing.
Yes,
right.
It's similar to new. I think I can even write new. This would also work. It's just a little different syntax. Okay. So, and I had a set name, get name method in my Java code, and the just transpiler generates for me a set name and a string, and if I want to access it, the get name, getter method. So if you're familiar with Objective-C, it's really easy for you to use it, and it's straightforward. There's a naming convention, how method names will be met and translated. And yeah, I can.
Do you have the constraint that in your Java code, can you use third-party libraries or?
That's the bad thing here. In J2Objc, you need all the source code. You need to have all sources.
And it's smart enough, if you, as long as you have the source, and it's smart enough to scan all the packages and import to the source.
Yes. Just echoes here in my console. What I just called here. I have some more advanced examples here. For example, what I can do. It works with interfaces, classes. I can use almost every Java thing. Here, and it will translate it. I have also the possibility to call from my Java code into Objective-C functions and Objective-C code, which is really, really nice. It works a little bit like GWT is up here. GWT for us with this GWT GSNI bridge. I can use those comments, for example, here. And import an Objective-C class from which is not implemented in Java, and annotate a method as native, and provide in the comment an Objective-C implementation for it. So, and I can also use this conditionals. For example, if I want to use the Java code in an Android project and reuse it in an Objective-C project, I can put these conditionals in my code and decide during compilation time which branch should be used. For example, if I have, if I need to calculate prime numbers or something like this, and I have a very, very efficient way to do it in Java Objective-C, and it's different which library I would use. I can use with conditionals, and then on Android it would use library A, and on iOS it would use another library. So I can use these conditionals, and also, set those objects as parameters in Java code, and also the other way around. So it's basically it's all object you see in the end. It's just
so
another.
Since you're in the Java world right now, I guess targeting Android is not a big problem because it's the same language. But when you're going to Objective-C, obviously, you still need to know the calling conventions, what libraries you need to bring in. It might be a little challenging, I assume, right?
Yeah, that's the case. You need to know Objective-C also. You can reuse a lot of functionality which you already implemented in Java. The way I got to these projects was it's a customer project from automotive area, and they have those huge systems for car diagnosis, and it's all written in Java, and it runs on all embedded devices on every platform. But now the customer said, "Hey, here's my iPad. run it here," and they said, "No, we can't do it because it's all written in Java, and you're not allowed to run a real JVM on Java." So we looked into all these approaches, and for that it's great. It's I think it's made up of almost 30 to 40 Eclipse projects, huge code base in it, has all threading stuff in SQLite database and Bluetooth connections, so it's really very difficult code.
Yeah.
And we got almost everything of it translated with J2Objective-C.
Yeah.
So
was
they have to build these bridges and sometimes map types.
Yeah. But was that a hard to maintain,
actually? It was more proof of concept. So we're not into this maintenance. We don't have much experience in how it really feels in production.
Since you have some experience with the JavaScript bridges, would it be more logical and easier to maintain in the JavaScript bridge versus this approach, or do you prefer this way?
Actually, I would prefer this way, because the JavaScript bridging thing, it's very dynamic, and I personally am a big fan of this static type languages, and knowing in advance how my project will behave and what will happen. But maybe that's a personal preference. So there are other people who might prefer the JavaScript approach, but there are other ways to achieve this dynamic behavior. It's mainly by not making the program dynamic, but making data structures more generic, or making the code, the framework, more generic. So you can achieve similar things with which are easier to maintain.
Still, it sounds like quite a bit of work doing it this way, and I'm wondering whether it's all worth it. Do you get a lot of requests like that? Yeah, in particular, what's the market share of Android versus iOS in Germany?
I think it should be roughly similar to the States. I think Android is a little bit more more common in Germany than Apple from the market, but it's no huge difference, I think, to the US. I think what's really important to note here, it really makes sense to use this approach if you have some existing code base which you can simply rewrite quickly into the other language. If you have a good Objective-C programmer and you have just this 10 classes in Java, it might not be worth it.
Can I also say something? Obviously, this is the first time I'm seeing this one. I didn't try that one. Might be worthwhile to try. But I did do a lot of Objective-C code. And in some part of it, I did go back to C++ because I have a strong C++ background. And probably you can easily fall back to C++ because it's a super sort of set of Objective-C. you can still compile and maybe you'll feel more comfortable because it's basically a C-based language in Objective-C. Even though it's a C-based language, it's supposed to be the naming conventions, calling, parameter passing is quite different.
I think to Objective-C, there's some compiler flag you can set, then it won't generate Objective-C code, but actually C++ code.
Yeah, that might be easier, for specifically for us, for Java. Okay.
I have not tried it out,
okay.
But I remember there was something in the documentation about that. So, yeah, the really the big drawback I see with this approach is that you need to have all the source code.
Yes.
This might be really a killer for this, but for Google Drive, Google had all the source code.
or decompile it.
Or decompile it, yes. I think based on the time, I won't go into much more details here and would like to show you the RoboVM, the other approach, which I personally think is more interesting. Yeah, but I have this second the data robot.
Okay.
So, slides. Okay. That was it to give you just a quick introduction and maybe get J2 Objective-C on your radar. So, you know, open your toolbox. There's a tool you can use if it's suitable for you. The other project I wanted to show you is called RoboVM. The mission statement on their website is to bring Java to iOS and do it properly and to empower the Java developer. I thought I have to put this statement here for the Java.
That's good.
What is RoboVM? It's a little bit different approach. No, it's a totally different approach. But you can do some similar things and even more. First of all, it's not a transpiler, it's a cross-compiler working on Java bytecode. It translates Java bytecode to native ARM or x86 code for you. It's an open source project driven by Trillium Mobile AB. I think they are from Sweden, Göteborg, and it's already used in a lot of mobile games based on a libgdx gaming, Java gaming platform. And there are probably, last time I looked, 50 to 60 games in the App Store already, which were written in Java and cross-compiled to iOS using RoboVM. And the goal of RoboVM is different than for J2Objective-C. It's really to build complete iOS apps, including the native UIs and full hardware access of iOS in Java. Has someone of you already had a look at RoboVM or Xamarin? Yeah. So, at first when I read this, I thought they are crazy and this will not work. I'm really big fan of native development and using Objective-C for iOS development and Java for Android development. But when I had a look at this and programmed the first few examples, it really didn't feel so bad and it worked. And so I thought maybe it's a good thing for the talk.
You wouldn't have the same project for Android and iOS in this case. You just would have an iOS project in Java, right?
Yeah, actually, it's you would reuse the code a little bit differently. It's basically, if you use RoboVM as an approach, you would have a multi-project setup, for example, like Maven or Gradle setup with the UI code. Mm-hmm. With RoboVM for iOS, the UI code in Android, for Android obviously, or JavaFX or Swing or whatever for your desktop app, and then you would have a core module containing all the common code, Java code, which is common to all the different platforms. And then try to push as much code as possible into this common area so you can reuse as much as possible. But the nice thing here is also for the other modules, you would need just the knowledge in Java. So you can, Java developers can do, they don't have to learn a new language. But there's another point, maybe I will mention it now. It's convenient to get started with it as a Java developer because you don't have to learn new language concepts and all these crazy weird phrases and Objective-C, it looks so terrible and you don't have to do that. But on the other hand, that's not really the difficult thing with Objective-C and iOS development. The real challenge, but also the real power comes from understanding the frameworks, the COCO frameworks, the libraries, and you still would have to learn them using RoboVM. So, okay, something about the licenses. The tooling is GPL, so you have to contribute if you change extend things, but the runtime part of it is Apache, so it's really business friendly. The runtime they use is actually the Android 4.3 Android runtime. So all Java language features which are supported in Android 4.3 are supported with RoboVM. And they are working on changing this to support OpenGDK. So they don't have the constraints of Android as the runtime platform. They have, although it's a very young project, they have a lot of good tooling already. They have some Eclipse plugins. They have Gradle plugins, Maven plugins. 2 days ago, somebody contributed an IntelliJ plugin, and you can really create App Store-ready apps. They integrated all the signing, provisioning profile stuff, this, certificate help, you might know if you're familiar with iOS development. You can find more information under roboVM.com, and it basically sends you to also to the GitHub site. The main core developer of RoboVM made the following statement. He said, RoboVM is probably not production ready, but it's used in so many productive apps, so he will remove the not production ready from the website, because it really depends on you what you want to do with it. It's the thing which RoboVM can do. It's okay documented. Everything which it states it can do will work, but there are some exotic things you want to try out, and they cannot guarantee it to work. Important to note is that it works on the bytecode, so everything which uses dynamically created, generated bytecode during runtime will not work. Because the topic is you have to create a statically linked library. iOS does not allow you to use dynamically linked libraries, so you need to generate everything during the compile process, and so it cannot figure out what objects are created or changed during runtime. First I thought, that's a really bad thing, but actually it's not so common used so often in all the frameworks you would use. And I had the problem wondering what with the AOP frameworks, can I use them? but they often, like aspect J and all this stuff, but very often they have some flags to change from dynamic reading into static reading. So you have to change your process a little bit, your tool chain a little bit, but then you can also have all the benefits from this more higher level advanced framework. Also dependency injection, annotation processing, all this stuff works.
So
which
any thoughts
great.
On like Spring or how to better actually talk about this?
Yeah, if they are dynamically created, it will not work.
Okay.
But if you have static proxies, this will work.
So it sounds like also different languages that's running on top of JVM
yes.
could be used
yeah.
like Scala.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
There are some examples in GitHub. I have not tried them out.
So
Scala, Groovy,
if
Kotlin,
if
they
if
all
you're not
should
using
work.
Reflection, I guess everything should be
Reflection
stable.
Works.
Reflection works?
Reflection is fully supported. So
only thing you're not going to generate dynamically
yes.
and requires late binding.
Yes. Everything which requires late binding is
not
supported.
Okay.
Because it's not, what they do is they don't embed a real JVM on the iOS device, but they have this environment runtime, they pretend to be a JVM.
Okay.
And yeah, it, but it's not interpreted Java code. It's really binary ARM code that is executed, which also means compared to some Java versions of the same code, it can run a lot faster actually on iOS than on Android. Maybe this changes with the ARM runtime, but I found that pretty interesting or funny. Okay. Yeah, the Eclipse plugin is probably the fastest way to get started with it. You can find it in the Eclipse market. Just search for RoboVM and the plugin pops up, and you have this new project wizard and this context menu extension in the project view. I will show you later some example of it. Let's look to get started, to get the first feeling. Look at the same example we started with J2Objc. If we want to cross-compile something, we can call the RoboVM compiler. And maybe I should have left out the path of my personal installation. Okay. You provided the class path, where to look for class files, and you provided with the main class, so the compiler knows where to start with the cross-compiling. And it works in a way that it transitively goes out from the main class, and everything which is accessed transitively will be cross-compiled. But so everything which is actually used in your code will be cross-compiled. Language features or things which are not used are not cross-compiled, not integrated in the library. So it's the footprint is reasonable. It's okay. And I think the JVM environment stuff itself is around 6 or 7 megabyte on top for the runtime stuff. Some of you might wonder now if it transitively goes down my AST, my syntax tree and my dependencies, what about reflection? Then there's a configuration file which you can add and tell the compiler, hey, please also link this class and this class and this class. And there you put all the packages, or you can use wildcards to include.
So do you have an exposure to the AST or abstract syntax tree? So you can link additional libraries?
Yes. Yes. And a very nice thing is you can actually get iOS libraries and link them. So write wrapper code around this. There are some examples of people who use Atmore, Fin Google Analytics and all these iOS libraries, and wrote this Fin Java wrapper around it. So you can use the native third-party libraries also in Java. This is really convenient. So coming back to the example, this is the main class you get here, and after running this command, the object files are created. Big difference to J2Objc, the input here are the classes and not the Java source files. So you have your usual Gradle, Maven, ARM, whatever build process, create all your jars, your class files, and then you let RoboVM work on the generated classes. Let's look at some examples.
Just out of curiosity, use this compiler. Is it LLK compiler? And let me know. Left to right with the left node orientation with the K lookup? Or
actually, I don't know. I have looked that deep into the compiler itself.
Could you use LLK? What does that mean?
It's basically when you're compiling the code source, code, creating the abstract syntax tree, and then down there, doing optimization of the object.
And then execute it. I'm not 100% sure, but I think I read they use some of the Eclipse tooling for getting the AST and then working on the AST with the JDT tooling, which they integrate, I think. Dive into the RoboVM examples. Source, I have the Hello World program, and in the bin I already compiled it with Eclipse. I have the class file here, and now I run the RoboVM command. And initially it takes really a long time to run it the first time, because all the Java classes from the Android Java runtime are cross-compiled first time, but they have the class cache, so the next time it will be a lot faster. So this process you just saw took about 15 minutes the first time. So, but I think it's okay if it only happens once. And what you can see here in the output, it compiled the classes and used the creating an executable and used the clang, the Xcode tool chain, then to create the binary and link everything, all the object files has together. So as a result, I now have the Hello World binary for X. I can let it run and it prints out everything. This is native code running on OS X. Yeah. And the nice thing is here I can use external libraries and dependencies. My favorite networking library, my favorite database library. And in the project I did, it was really great. We had to try out the J2Objc and RoboVM approach, and we have this challenge to integrate a SQLite database and access it. And for J2Objc, I had to write this bridge and call it and create the SQLite integration in Objc and then call it from Java and stuff. But here, as they included the Android runtime, I just could use the Android JDBC driver for SQLite. So everything could be written in Java to access the database, which I thought was really neat. Okay, let's look at some little bit more advanced examples of it. Is it big enough? Can you read it? As I wanted to save you from the pain to watch me type everything, I prepared different steps. So, but there's no magic in between the different steps. It's just adding a little code, which I will explain. So, okay, I installed the Eclipse plugin. I told you you can find it in the marketplace. You have a quite new project. Now you have the create RoboVM iOS project. It starts up. Project name, you can decide on which platform it should compile, which operating system, Linux, iOS, Voice X, and you have this typical iOS app settings, like the main class, how it's called, the app name, and the app ID, the bundle identifier. And then you create it, it will basically create a just the project structure, including three files. The first one is the RoboVM properties. This includes the things which you entered in the wizard. And RoboVM XML file, which is used to configure the RoboVM compiler. So all the compiler flags telling the compiler to link additional classes, additional libraries. This can be all configured in the RoboXML, RoboVM XML file. So it's a configuration file for the RoboVM compiler. And I created a simple class to get started with. It's from the packages, RoboVM, they cross-compiled and bridged the whole Cobo libraries. And you see here, I have the RoboVM runtime jar. This is basically the Android runtime. So everything in Java, Java util, JavaNet, java.io, all that I can use from Android. And it also includes the Cocoa Touch libraries, which are is all the Objective-C iOS API. Yeah.
Does it depend on a certain version of Cocoa, or like does it work? Does it look at your system and pull the libraries from there?
It's dependent on a version for which it was built.
Okay.
So in, but it's really actual. So it's really they're really up to date. This is already iOS 8 that is supported here in the us on their website. They have a table. With listed with all the Cocoa Touch and Cocoa libraries, it's 50 or 60 libraries, and UIKit, Core Bluetooth, Core Animation, all the stuff, and the status, how far they are with bridging it. And the last time I checked, they were about 60-70%. And the goal of the RoboVM project is to release this year the first final 1.0 version, which should cover the whole Cocoa Touch. So, there are also a lot of examples in GitHub, people using it, Core Data or Core Bluetooth stuff, and writing it in Java. It's weird. It's crazy. That's the runtime. And I created this main class. So if you look down here, the first thing is we call UI application main method. This is our iOS demo class, which in turn implements or extends the UI application delegate adapter. And those familiar with iOS development know this is the entry point for iOS application to get the UI up and configure UI or the views and everything and get started. A little bit similar to the application class in Android. Android, where you can also start more, get all the activities started. So, what am I doing here? It's really no rocket science. I'm creating a new window, and I'm telling the window to take the same size as my screen, the screen has. I'm setting a background color here, and op, this is exactly the Coco Touch API. With some conventions, they transformed it into Java. And I create here an UI label, set its position and its size, set a color, add a text, and then I have to add this label as a subview to my window so that it will appear and tell the window, make key window and make yourself visible. And basically, that's it. I let it run. It will start. Okay, now it starts the cross compiler. My machine is not the fastest. It's an old i5. Okay. It starts, and here's our label. Let's make this example a little bit more advanced. Okay. I switch over to the second example. It's basically the same, the label. But I also added a button here. It's a UI button, create button, round frag. It's a standard iOS button. Set the frame to where should the button be positioned. We set a title, we set a tint color. And the nice thing that you can see here is the callback for the button click. I could also use lambda expressions.
Yeah.
Yay. Mm-hmm. So,
I was surprised to see that.
Me too. I found out yesterday.
I was expecting to see the expression.
Usually, I think the worst thing which I liked Objective-C a lot more than recent Java was the blocks and the lambda expression, the closures.
Mm-hmm.
And
now it's back in Java, I see.
Now
here, too,
here using those expressions and language features. Actually, I wondered why should I use Swift if I can use Java 8?
Mm-hmm.
It looks very similar, and it's a little more powerful based on all the frameworks available already in this language. But Swift is a nice language, but it's not that much difference if you can use Java 8. So so I created the callback and added the label and the button to the view. Okay, what will happen? It will change the label with the number of how many times I click the button. Maybe that's not an app you would distribute in the App Store. What was that with the Yo app?
Yeah.
I'm so angry I did not do it. Okay, here we have the button. When we click it, yay, Java code. I'm running Java 8 with the callback. Okay, but like I said, probably that's not the way how you would implement iOS apps. So typically you would have something like view controllers and views and table views and alerts, dialogues and all this stuff. And it's like when you program in Android, you have all this Android infrastructure and classes and framework code which you can use. So I prepared a demo. It's a little bit more sophisticated, has a little bit more iOS to it. So for those of you who are not too much involved in iOS development, if you have any questions about what you see here, just go in and ask me. So we have our main class, and what we do here is for window, we want to present a table view with some items in it. And the first thing is we create a new table view controller. Yeah. View controller, you can, as Android developers, you can think of an activity. A view controller is very similar to an activity or fragment. And here also I want to get this behavior with the back button, which is typical for iOS. I put something on the stack and I get automatically this back button in the left corner. Then I click it, I get to the previous screen. And how do you do this in iOS? In Cocoa, you use a UI navigation controller. That's the root controller in your view hierarchy, and you add, it holds a stack of controllers in it and manages all the behavior to push and pop controllers. So I create a navigation controller. Here, this is iOS specific and necessary for the garbage collection, because the garbage collection and memory management is different in iOS and Objective-C runtime than to Java. Adding a strong reference makes sure that the object is not destroyed immediately, because only objects which have a strong reference, a pointer showing to it, will be kept alive in memory. So I had to explicitly adhere the strong ref. And here I can set another delegate which reacts to clicks and actions there. And my window is now set to the navigation controller, and the navigation controller holds the table view controller. Okay? So the basis is my window. It contains the navigation controller. My navigation controller contains my table view controller. And let's look at the table view controller. It's pretty much straightforward. It extends UI table view controller, the Cocoa class. And later I want to also show an UI alert dialog. So it implements the alert view delegate. So it gets notified when a button is clicked in the alert view. I set up some demo data, and in the view controller lifecycle, one of the lifecycle methods that is called is the viewDidLoad method. It tells, okay, all the view hierarchy, all the objects which are going to appear soon on the view are now created, and here's your chance, you can modify the view or add additional elements to it. We register a table view cell class, because we want to create table cells. So we register a class so that this class is dequeued and reduced. It's the same in Android with the view adapters. If you have 10,000 objects in your table, you don't want to create 10,000 cell objects. So if a cell is scrolled out of the view, it's reused with the next cell that comes in. So you, for 10,000 objects to scroll through, you typically have 5 or 10 view cells for them. And this is basically what this registration does. For the table view, we have some callbacks. So the table view asks the view controller, hey, how high should a row be? And it asks, how many rows should I present? And here it's simple, it's just the length of the sample data, and I made a fixed high 80 points. And yeah, the next thing is the table view calls the getRow method. In iOS it's called cellForRow at index path. It translates to the getRow. And here tells you on the table view that should be presented, and gives you an index path telling you I want to render the third, the fourth, the fifth element, and give me the UI you want to show there. Here I DQ the cell I registered previously and get the row and can set the content of the cell, for example, setting the name, an image, the color, the appearance of the view. And basically, that's it to make the table appear. And if I click on a table cell, the action that is triggered is the did select row action. It gives me the index path that the user clicked. And there I can decide, okay, get the data. And in this example, show an alert view. Okay, we set this ourselves as a delegate for the alert view. We implemented the alert view delegate interface. So then the user clicks cancel or OK. Our view controller is called. And it's the clicked method. And here we can figure out what to do based on the cell that was clicked. Any questions so far? I think it's, if you program in Swing or in Android, it's not that big difference, especially when you see it in Java and in Objective-C. Okay. I did some other thing here. Trying to show a little bit how you would reuse code between different, but still talking about multi-platform development, how you would reuse code, because this code is iOS specific, right? It's Java, but it's iOS specific. And as an example, I just wrote this little Java function library remote connection example. Don't kill me, this is not production code, it's ugly code, I know, but it should prove the point. This code does not import anything from RoboVM, from iOS or Android specific, it's just plain Java. And it could be a third party library, it could be included or whatever. And here I'm using the HTTP URL connection, open the connection, send a request to a server, get an image back from a server, and use the file system API with the file input stream, file output streams, and save this file on the device. And the nice thing here is it's platform independent code. You don't see anything Android or iOS specific in here. And in that way, you would factor out all the stuff and put this into a common library that is shared between the different. I need to run my mock server. Let's serve the file. Okay, so when I click the OK button in the alert view, it will find out what's the document directory where I can save the file. It takes the URL to the file. It's now here, it's a Node.js or something, static web server. Then it downloads the file. And the next thing it does, it uses the navigation controller and pushes a new demo image view controller on the navigation controller. So if I click OK, a new controller will appear, and this controller will simply load the image from the disk where I save it and present it. Fancy. Create an UI image view, load the file from the documents view where I saved it, set the image, and add the image view as a subview. native Vertex view controller, right? And the nice thing is compared to this hybrid approaches, this really native, it's native ARM code in Java, so it's as fast as if it would be if you write it directly in Objective-C, or in, maybe not in C, but it's really binary code for the platform. I get the native dialog, and it's not a dialog which looks like the native dialog. What you get from the hybrid approaches, it's actually this is the native operating system dialog you get, and when I click OK, yay, it is loaded. And you also see from the navigation controller, I have this back button here. It's always the same image, but here it looks a bit funny in the simulator with the transition, but on the device it looks just fine. Maybe one last example. I won't go into the details, but quickly start the project. This is different. It's also written in RoboVM, and as a third-party library, here it uses the Maven build process. Hopefully it does not download the whole internet. I wanted, is anyone here of the developers who never had an issue with Maven dependencies, downloading stuff, where it simply worked?
You need a local proxy and caching for your company.
Yeah.
Not so difficult.
And luck. Okay, now it's linking the classes. It's a little bit bigger example. Ta-da! JavaFX app running in iOS. Select stuff, sort columns. I think this is the standard address book example from the JavaFX tutorials. It's simply integrated in my transfer log in RoboVM. Yep, you see some of the drawbacks. The UI, the keyboard goes over the UI, so you would have to adjust this and work around this, because JavaFX does not know anything of the keyboard. Have the stuff here, so it's JavaFX code running in iOS. I think it's really ugly. If you're an iOS user, you really expect a different UI and user experience. But I think this is especially true if you have this kind of forms and you have to enter data. But if you have something using animations and more like a widget UI, which is not so much form-based and user interactive with entering text data stuff, I think JavaFX might even be a good choice. Just I wouldn't do an app where I have a lot of forms and something like this, or tables which look like this. This feels alien to an iOS user and also to an Android user. But I really thought it's a miracle that this works. Okay. slides. This concludes the first part with the Java on iOS. I hope you enjoyed it. And looking forward to do the second part with Data Robot.
Are these on slide share?
Not yet, but I think I will. Do you have some space?
Yes, you know, I take the slides and post them on our Yahoo group or our website. You can get to them, so they'll be up along with the video. How long is the second presentation?
It's shorter.
So why don't we take 5 minutes so that people get up, finish the pizza, go use the restroom, and we'll start back up at precisely 8:30.